but it demonstrates the global scope of the issue of tree pathogens, which presents a growing problem because forests need to be healthy to survive climate change, and a changing climate is facilitating the spread of many of these tree pathogens. These are some common symptoms of tree diseases, and we know quite a lot about these direct impacts on trees. But our current knowledge of the indirect and long-term effects of tree species becoming diseased is still limited. We do know that many of the tree species affected are dominant in their ecosystem, and sometimes even regarded as keystone species or ecosystem engineers. And we also know that many of the tree species affected are iconic and culturally significant. So while our current literature on ecosystem impacts of tree pathogens is still fairly sparse, it doesn't take genius to predict that the sickness or the loss of these tree species will have consequences. This includes a reduction in primary production, impacts on ecological relationships within tree communities, thinking about symbiotic relationships between plants, animals, microbes, changes or even the loss of ecosystem services, impacts on ecosystem nutrient and gas fluxes, evolutionary processes might change, both in the host organisms and in organisms that are related to the invading pathogens, and the demise of native species. So in our research team, we study the ecosystem impacts of Kauri dieback. And like I said, I'll present just a little bit of the work done by only some of the people in our team. And this work is based on data that was collected from three sites in the Waitakere Ranges, where Kaurā Amaki are the iwi. And despite Rāhui, we're allowed to do research there, so it's quite special to go there and do field work. So to better understand what happens to a forest when it is under stress, we started looking at a few of its components, such as what happens to the leaf litter chemistry. So Isara found that the concentration of carbon was higher in the leaves from Kauri in which the pathogen was detected, while the concentrations of calcium and copper were lower. Okay, so what about decomposition of these leaves? That's already a more complex question. Soil decomposer organisms need enzymes to break down organic materials such as leaf litter. And Kara found that the activity of enzymes used to decompose simple carbon compounds was higher at trees where a pathogen was detected. And enzymes involved in decomposition of complex carbon compounds, although less effective, had a similar pattern and also seemed to be a bit more active at trees where a pathogen was detected. Microbes are key organisms involved in decomposition, and to measure microbial activity, we buried pre-weighed tea bags, we let them decompose in the soil, and then measured the mass loss over time. And Siki, who is also here today, did a first attempt at this, but unfortunately, due to COVID lockdown, she couldn't retrieve the bags in time, so the tea decomposed a bit too much. But then Lundberg did a second attempt, and she found a higher mass loss of the royal tea when the pathogen was detected at that tree. Went out and did a third attempt in winter, and it followed a slightly different protocol, but I found again the same result, a higher decomposition of royal tea when the pathogen was detected. So this is really cool, three different people, slightly different methods, different times, slightly different locations next to the tree, but we're all finding the same results. And so my hope is that this means that if you know the baseline of rooibos decomposition at our tree, an increase in the decomposition of that tea might possibly be an early indicator, although this is still an extrapolation at this point. So an impact of the pathogen on decomposition could have knock-on effects on greenhouse gas emissions because decomposition is carried out by lots of these decomposer organisms, which form form the soil food web, and they live and breathe CO2 just like us. So they contribute to greenhouse gas emissions. And the soil food web is a complex web of relationships between soil organisms, and it basically describes who eats who or who eats what in the soil. And it includes microbes, which we measure the activity of the tea bags, but it also includes somewhat larger organisms, such as these mites and springtails, which are collectively called mesofauna. And at our trees, I found that the pathogen presence seemed to have no effect on the number of these mesofauna living at that tree. But I also found that kauri trees generally supported a lower number of mesofauna compared to broadleaf trees in the same patch of forest. And this might be because kauri litter has a bit more of a, let's say, acquired taste, which might end up with a different mesofauna community. And this suggests that an eventual loss of kauri trees and a shift to an ecosystem that is more dominated by broadleaves rather than kauri is still likely going to impact the soil food web somehow. And then roots, these are the first point of infection of the kauri bacteriophage pathogen. And Jenny, who is also here today, found that at kauri trees, the biomass of kauri fine roots was lower when the pathogen was detected, while non-kauri fine roots were not affected. So this suggests a decrease below ground ecological dominance of kauri as the pathogen starts to take hold. So in conclusion, we're slowly starting to build a more complete picture of what is happening to the ecosystem as an effect of this particular tree pathogen. And at this stage, we might maybe carefully conclude that some components and processes seem to be more linked with the actual presence of the pathogen, which I've indicated here with some red arrows, while others might depend more on what tree species are dominant in the ecosystem. So thank you for your attention, and sorry for the rocky start. And thank you to all the people and organizations involved, including some who I've surely missed out on this slide, sorry. And I look forward to your questions, comments, and chat.
Kia ora.